Has there ever been a time in your life where you found yourself in a certain scenario and you think, how did I get here? Or I don't belong here. It's that feeling where you don't have all the answers, but you're just hoping that no one discovers that. I'm willing to bet that most of us have been there before, and maybe you've heard this phrase, fake it until you make it. That means that if you don't know what you're doing or don't know what to do next, just pretend. Pretend that you know what you're doing and have such confidence on the outside that it makes other people believe it. It can feel like you're wearing a mask and pretending to be something that you're not. This feeling and this experience is called imposter syndrome. It's the constant fear of being exposed as a fraud. It's an individual experience of self-perceived phoniness. It's a subconscious feeling that we impose on ourselves out of insecurity and fear. Imposter syndrome is a pervasive feeling of self-doubt, insecurity, and fraudulence, despite often overwhelming evidence to the contrary. It's not something that others impose on us. It's wholly imparted by our own feelings and conscience. You know, a couple years ago, I was in Washington, D.C. for work. One of my clients hosts a yearly conference where hundreds of people from around the world come to talk about intellectual property and antitrust and regulatory cases surrounding wireless communication and technology. I was there with a production crew and we were shooting probably a dozen interviews with different people on these complicated topics. We were in a room just outside the main conference room hall and everything was set up and we were ready for our first interviewee to come in. I've conducted interviews before, so I knew the drill. I also watched a lot of Barbara Walters and 60 Minutes growing up, so I know how to shake my head. I know how to scratch my chin as if I was thinking about the next question to ask or how to make the person sitting across from me feel like I know what I'm talking about. And I did a lot of research leading up to this. I read into all the people I'd be talking to and their areas of focus and specializations and even their life achievements, pretty much anything I could find. But the moment that the camera started rolling, I felt a giant wave of anxiety rush over me. They were sitting there about 10 feet in front of me, just waiting for me to ask the first question. I did this about 12 times that day, and each time I couldn't shake that feeling that they could see past all of the big words that I knew, the industry jargon and my references to relevant topics. I needed them to know that I knew what I was talking about, that I was smart enough to be there with them, interviewing the previous Supreme Court justice, the sitting senator, the CEO that makes seven figures every year. And there I was, a 28, 29-year-old with imposter syndrome, just asking a couple questions off a sheet of paper. Over the years of doing the same thing, I got more comfortable and familiar knowing what I was talking about than the year before. But a couple years into doing this, I decided to do something different. It was probably after 3 or 4 years of interviewing the same most powerful and influential people that I've ever been on one-on-one with. I started doing the interviews by doing something different. You know, once the cameras were rolling, they were sitting there across from me waiting for me to ask that question to break the silence. I'd simply say, hey, you're the expert. I know a little bit about this stuff, but really talk to me like I know nothing about this. That was a game changer for me. That immediately put my mind to ease and my guard came down knowing that I was no longer pretending to know it all. I wasn't pretending to be something that I wasn't. It also made conversations so much more open and productive. I was getting the answers I wanted in a clearer way than ever before. The same is true for our spiritual lives. Imposter syndrome can be one of the greatest things keeping us from growth. You see, imposter syndrome is performative. It's superficial. It's putting on a front that hides our true selves. And that's the only thing that Jesus wants from us, our truest self. Do you feel imposter syndrome in your spiritual life? Do you look at others who have more notes in their Bible, more pages earmarked, more lines highlighted? Maybe you have friends who are more consistent with their daily devotionals, and maybe you feel like you've never will ever be able to pray as good as somebody else. In Matthew 6, Jesus tells Christians how to give, how to pray, and how to fast, how to be our true self in him. Verse 5, he says, "And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words." Jesus called out the performative efforts and rituals and showmanship that the religious leaders of his time were known for doing. He said that doesn't serve God, who knows and sees what happens in secret. Imposter syndrome would say that we need to pray out loud all the time, using big words and babbling like pagans in order for it to be most effective. But you don't need to have the perfect words to pray. You don't have to have perfect ingredients. There's no secret code or heightened level of intellect or education that you need to talk to God. In Philippians, Paul talks about having no confidence in the flesh. Chapter 3, verse 8, he writes, "I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ." The righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith, not that I have already obtained all of this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of for me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind me and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Jesus. Paul has overcome his imposter syndrome. He recognizes that everything he has, he does, and he is for the sake of Jesus. And that second part, that's the key here, is not that I have already obtained this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of what Christ Jesus took hold of in me. He's saying that he doesn't know it all. He's saying he doesn't have all the answers, but he owns the fact that he will persevere. He'll continue to lean into the life and the love of Jesus that he knows that brings him life and salvation. We don't have to have all the answers. And honestly, anybody, any Christian that claims to have all the answers is an imposter. You see, faith is a journey. It's a journey through a relationship with God, and that relationship is personal. It's unique to each and every one of us. No two people will have the same journey with God. You know, growing up in the church, I struggled with imposter syndrome often. I would hear all these awesome and super transformative stories or testimonies of how people came to know Jesus. Whether it was overcoming addictions or coming from a bad family background or upbringing or riding on too many motorcycles with the wrong people, I was always fascinated that these people had such cool testimonies of how Jesus worked in their lives. I didn't have any of that. I had a great family. I didn't ride motorcycles and still don't because my mom would kill me. And I didn't have this drastic transformation story, so I felt inadequate and often questioned whether I truly had a relationship with Jesus because there was no radical transformation. But the older I get, the more I realize that the journey to Jesus is so radically different for everyone. Sometimes that journey happens in an instant, and in a moment of realization for some people. Some people it happens over the course of years as he works in our lives, but the journey never ends. And as we continue on this journey to live each and every day, striving to know Jesus more than yesterday and less than tomorrow, remember that imposter syndrome happens to everyone, whether they want to admit it or not. What makes you a real Christian is not your own perfection, but Jesus's perfection living and working in us. Paul gets at it again in 2 Corinthians and talking about a vision he had and asked God to take away this thorn that he had in his side or this torment that he had. But the Lord said to him, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." Paul goes on to say, therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness and insults and hardships and persecutions and difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. It's probably hard for a lot of us to admit that we have these weaknesses, especially when it comes to our faith. But Paul had such excitement and such fervor about celebrating his weaknesses. He was celebrating that he didn't have all the answers, because that only means that there's more work to be done. That because of our weakness and in those times when we feel like an imposter, Jesus is working within us and through us wherever, whenever, and whether we can see it or not. Imposter syndrome isn't something to be afraid of. It's not something we often have control over. No, but when we are able to recognize this in our lives and take action on it, that's when we'll be able to see all the things work together for good to those who love Jesus. So this week, when you find yourself in a place of doubt, of insecurity or anxiety, or when you feel like an imposter, wearing a mask and pretending, remember that your relationship with Jesus is not based on what you know or how much you do, but it's based on what you let Jesus do through you. We'll see you next week.